Добрый день, вы смотрите видеоканал GameScope. Это с вами Диана. Сегодня мы находимся в гостинице «Украина», где пройдет пресс-конференция по фильму «Штурм Белого дома», которую представит режиссер Алан Эммерих. Он расскажет о том, как создавался боевик, где главные роли сыграли Джейми Фокс и Ченнинг Татум. Теперь давайте посмотрим репортаж с этой конференции целиком.
Аплодисментами поприветствуем в этом зале Роланда Эммериха, режиссера фильма «Штурм Белого дома». И еще одна просьба, пожалуйста, отключите мобильный телефон, для того, чтобы Xbox не мешал общению.
Sometimes it's when it's only one in the family is the actor, it's not really. so that we grow. And I think she will be active. She's a forward actress, and she's incredible talent.
Speech, вы можете талант можно каким образом?
But you know, I think she is relatively grown up for such a young lady. I mean, she knows exactly what she wants. She came to me with a total view how she wanted to play the part. She said to me she just wanted to play and socially distressed. So that tells you she. And I agree with her. I said like the more courageous she can play her, the more you will like her, probably like her. And I think she's a real, real discovery.
Это действительно так. Дорогие друзья, пожалуйста, ваши вопросы. Представьтесь, не забывайте представляться.
Добрый день, спасибо большое за время. У вас сейчас очень бодрое зрелище, мы становимся трогательными. Скажите, пожалуйста, дала ли какой-то легенд на съемке то, что практически эту легенду много раньше вышел в фильме «Аминь Аминь»?
When I started, decided to do White House Down, I was not aware of this as well. I would have probably thought twice if I wanted to do it, because I had no idea that they were doing the same thing. And then when I had just had cast, you know, Channing Tatum, and I was on the way to Louisiana, somebody told me about this other film. But at that time they didn't have a director, so I thought, how can they ever, be this? And then they hired a director, and after they hired a director, 5 weeks later they started shooting. So, I think the two movies are quite different from each other. They have a very different feel to each other, so. And they have also like Iron Man 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. It's always the same character.
So.
It's my third time in Moscow. Naturally, the first time I came with 2012, it was really exciting. Because also we had a little bit more time. It was the beginning part of the tour, so they always give you a little bit more time, and I could visit the Kremlin and a couple of other sites. And, there's a tendency lately, to use disaster elements in a lot of movies, I see this now in a lot of the comic book hero films. They most of the time have an alien invasion and a lot of destruction that like kind of strikes me very familiar. To make these movies, they're very complicated, they're very complex, with a lot of actors. What you have to do is you have to find a way how to keep it light and keep a sense, that people are not stressing out too much. So I always try to be, very friendly set, where everybody can say whatever they want, and actually in this movie it is relatively extreme that all the actors always stay on the set, In certain movies, they all disappear in the trailers. In this one, there was such a great atmosphere on the set that most of the actors stayed on the set, And I kept saying to them, come to the trailers, not shooting in the next 20 minutes. And I said, no, we had no volunteer. And it was interesting how Jamie Foxx and Channing Tatum were always together, discussing something. Or Channing Tatum and Joey King were like a It is. So we had a, I think it was very, very good that there was such a friendly atmosphere and everybody loved, you know, to open the movie. So that always that kind of transfers a little bit to the movie. It makes this really hard work very much easier. When we here in 2012, we very consciously had an African American president, and so we didn't want to kind of do too blatantly Obama, but it was like meant as an endorsement of Obama, who at that time was still fighting with Hillary Clinton over the candidacy of his party. When I got the script for White House Now, it was like written as a very Obama-esque figure, also African American, and I didn't want to change it because I am a big supporter of President Obama, and it was before his re-election, so I didn't want to kind of cast a white actor because I didn't want to kind of endorse a Mormon, you know, for the presidency. So I don't think President Obama will always stay away from a movie like that because it's very close to home, and so he will probably never ever hear anything from him about the talk.
Маленькое дополнение, может быть, есть у вас реакция от кого-то из сотрудников, нынешних или бывших сотрудников секретной службы на вашу картину?
Well, we had a screening in Washington. And, you know, when you like kind of remember the film, there is this line, you know, the Secretary of Homeland Security is in the house, you're getting so fired for it. And actually the Secretary of Homeland Security was in the house watching the film and she loved it very much.
Следующее. Некоторые вещи, которые вы снимаете в своих фильмах, потом происходят в жизни. Например, напомню вам, что в 2013 Йеллоустоунский парк превратили в град. Через несколько лет нечто подобное произошло в Исландии. Потом в фильме «Послезавтра» вы начали с того, что заливали дождя. В этом году в Европе то же самое произошло. Как вы относитесь к тому, что у вас есть такой дар в русском предсказании? Спасибо.
When you like to make disaster movies, you know, there will always be disasters in this world. So you can always claim that you like to solve a couple of disasters. I get a lot of grief from my mom about Day After Tomorrow because she single-handedly said I'm not responsible that our weather is turned to shit. So. I think, you know, when you're like a filmmaker, you always have to take subjects, you know, which are really in people's daily lives. And I think all these occurrences of disasters that are really, really kind of affect people. So that's why I'm actually so interested in putting them in my movies.
Пожалуйста, следующий вопрос. Ваша девочка, она очень увлекается политикой. Американские дети действительно столько увлекаются политикой?
It is something which is unusual even in America. I kind of liked that character so much because she was, you know, a very extraordinary girl. And you also understand why she is interested in politics because she, when her father was deployed to Afghanistan, you know, she tried to connect with him and watched every news broadcasts, you know, about, you know, Afghanistan, and claims to have seen it. So that's how she discovered, you know, politics, which is hopefully, you know, when you like kind of create characters like that, you know, you like kind of try to entice other young people to be interested in politics, because I think the news of the day, it's not enough interesting politics. But also it has something to do with the media, which the media is very, at least in America, very doesn't go very deep.
Ron, трейлинг вашему фильму идут титры от автора «Дня независимости», «Послезавтра» и «2012». Но, честно говоря, для меня вы в первую очередь автор анонима. Я хотел спросить, не собираетесь ли вы еще порадовать нас не многобюджетным блокбастером, а авторским, умным, интеллектуальным и жестким кино? Спасибо.
I definitely want to do movies like Anonymous. They will look different. I have one project which is very dear to my heart, which I guess hopefully made as a movie about the Stonewall riots, 69 in New York, which was the starting point of the gay liberation movement. That's one. And I have two, three other historical drama which I would like to do. One is about a gentleman called Gonzalo Aguero, who was the first Spaniard ever landed in Yucatan and kind of went native. So I have several of these projects and I will hopefully all make them. I'm a little bit old now, so I have to hurry up. But one thing is for sure, I love to make them on this.
Пожалуйста, вы считаете, большой бюджет – это определяющее качество хорошего фильма или что-то другое? Создавать деньги, снять отличный фильм. И есть у вас какая-то мечта в плане вот, снять фильм, который вы давно хотели, но хотели получить по тем или иным причинам?
I just mentioned the movie which I want to do with now since quite some while, it's the Stonewall film. But I don't think movies, you know, are, you know, depend on their budgets. You know, certain films naturally need a certain budget. You know, but I think we did a movie like White House Down for a good budget. You know, it's you know, we were very tight with money. And yeah, I mean it's but it's a very interesting tendency in America at least. They either make very big movies over $100 million or under 20. There is nothing in between anymore. That's worries me. Well, I do this all the time. That's why I also obsess about the cast. For me, the most important thing as a director for me is finding, you know, the right cast. I think 80% of directing is finding the right cast. And when I shoot a movie, I try to create an atmosphere of cooperation. And what comes out of this is that I sometimes say to the actors, you know, because they know their characters so well, I say, like, now improvise. Just add whatever comes to your mind. Some of the best moments in my movies are always created through a conversation. Started already in my very first movie.
За последние, наверное, полгода, сколько к нам приезжало разных актеров, мы практически от всех слышали замечательные истории о том, что сейчас появилась в Голливуде тенденция вновь снимать на натуре, что намного дороже, чем на хромаке. Вот расскажите, пожалуйста, именно о натурных съемках ваших
актеров. I didn't shot on location, I shot on a stage. Because they didn't give me a shooting permit in the White House. And so we had to kind of build everything. And it's also to make it very difficult to actually shoot the White House. I remember when we shot planes for Independence Day, we could just walk up, put our camera right in front of the fence and shoot images. и мне надо угадать его. To make this nearly impossible. So we did actually only like maybe half a dozen shots in real, and everything else what you see is created in the computer. So actually it's because of digital cameras now it's quite convincing what you can do on stage. Does it look like the fake? Yes. Yes, it's like every movie now. It's that's like kind of why I'm really excited making movies because you can use like visual effects for all kinds of different things and just also I'm very into how exactly the light is. And, I can shoot something on stage, the sun is always in the same spot, so light never goes, and so you like have a much easier time to kind of create this image of what you have in your head on the film. Well, I was the first time seeing the White House was when I was 13 and a half. It was like visiting America and the host family I was staying with, like when I brought me to the White House and I really liked it. And the next time I saw the White House from the inside because I screamed Independence Day for Bill Clinton, you know, in the first family. And I saw the White House explode inside the White House. Although only a couple of people have seen that, people were 25. It was totally surreal. So the White House means something for me. It's I also like because if I was maybe so successful destroying the White House, I'd like to further my career. So I'm like very thankful to the White House. But this time around, it was for me more to create like some sort of a political thriller in the disguise of an action film, which just enticed me. I have done it once in a while to like kind of use somebody else's script. I did it actually three times in my life. It was The Patriot, Anonymous, and now White House Down. I actually was not planning for it. I still have that project. I wanted to do a movie called Singularity, which I still want to do. And I was just stuck with my writing partner Harold, who just stuck. We're like kind of not happy with the script. And then all of a sudden this other script appeared on my table. And when I saw the title, I said, no way, not again. But then out of courtesy, I started reading it. And it was one of the best scripts I've ever read. So, and it's very rare to get a really good action script. And I always like secretly wanted to actually do an action movie again. But then every director tries to put a stamp on a script. And in that case, you know, we did a lot of rewrites, you know, to the script.
Следующий вопрос, пожалуйста. Ром, послушай, я задам еще один, меня он очень сильно волнует. Есть такая традиция в российской педагогике. Если в классе есть два друга, которые постоянно веселятся, шутят, и никак не могут сидеть на месте, их нужно рассадить. Вот у вас не возникало желания рассадить на съемочной площадке Джейми Фокс и Ченни Миттена? Потому что, насколько я понимаю, они очень нервомальные, шутят постоянно и не мешало мне это работать.
Yeah, they were very unruly once in a while. I sometimes have to just say, stop joking around. Because they really, really liked each other, they supported each other. And especially Jamie Foxx, who had to wear a suit, constantly tried to show Channing Tatum how he has to stand so his arms look better. I said to Jamie, can you stop that? Because you know, Channing became more self-conscious about his position and his acting. So yeah, but it was never really very nice people.
Есть ли еще вопросы? Дорогие друзья, конечно же, есть.
Я взглянул на Rotten Tomatoes и посмотрел, что критики оценили вашу картину нынешнюю на 47%, а при этом зрители оценивают картину на 70%. Как вы считаете, может быть, вы вспомните какой-то самый веселый или какой-то самый смешной отзыв критиков о ваших фильмах, который вас сильно насмешал? Вы считаете ли вы критику на своей работе? Спасибо.
If I would read what critics write about my movies, I wouldn't make movies anymore. So I avoid them like the pest. Maybe the only thing what I once read, you know, was about Anonymous. And, you know, and it was like actually a year later after Anonymous came out, the Huffington Post declared Roland Emmerich finally proved wrong by four or five professors. And when I read the article, it was a total joke, which I kind of said, well, they never asked my statement. I could have, had an answer to every one of these points. So.
Пожалуйста, еще вопрос.
Один из сложных является в том, что сборная, в общем-то, ну, фактически совершается. Считаете ли вы, что на самом деле заложники, которые много часов приезжают в целом, в фильме, теперь могут заявиться таким образом?
Well, it was like kind of a little bit the character of this man. You know, he was this man who was like a conservative journalist who, was very upset that he had became a hostage. And I kind of thought it was more like, you know, a reason so to say even this like a conservative hostage can be a hero. And I don't think he wanted to commit suicide. He just tried to protect this little girl, and then he got shot in the leg. So I don't think it's. I think it's quite opportune to have a scene like that because it shows a little bit like anybody can be a hero.
Дорогие друзья, у нас остается время на один короткий последний вопрос.
Правда существует тоннель, который на этом направлении и Джон Кеннер.
No. the writer made that up. And it was the first thing when I actually said about the script, I said, Jamie, this tunnel doesn't exist. He says, but it's like so cool that this, and I said, okay. Because I was a big fan of the whole story about JFK, and he was, had some secret meetings with Marilyn Monroe. But they always met in the West Coast White House, which was his brother-in-law's, house in Santa Monica. So it was called the West House, White House, West Coast White House.
Большое спасибо, Роланд, огромное спасибо вам за картину.